here in Memphis, the home of Elvis and slow smoked barbecued food.
Yeah.
Wow. Yes.
Ribs are a religion here and are normally cooked either in a wet sauce or caked and marinated in a dry seasoning.
But in the spirit of rock and roll, we're gonna break the rules and put the two together.
First, you'll need a rack of baby back ribs.
So you roast this for 3 hours with the dry rub, and it just goes, dry.
And relaxes, and the meat comes away from the bone, and it's filled and infused with all of those spices and herbs.
Yeah. Oh. Then we make a wet rub.
Yes.
We paint it with the skill of Rembrandt, knocking up a masterpiece. Then we put that on the barbecue, you see, and it gets barbecued with a wet rub. So it's wet and dry, dry, wet. Honestly, it's the best rib you ever tasted.
Shall we crack on?
Start with a dry rub.
Brown sugar. So good. Two tablespoons of paprika. One tablespoon of salt.
What the salt does, it uses it as an accelerant to open the grains of said meat so all of those lovely herbs and spices penetrate into the body of the meat, which is important.
To the salt, sugar and paprika, you add 2 teaspoons each of black pepper, English mustard, cayenne pepper and dried oregano, or oregano in these parts. Now what we need to do is for Kingy to rub all of this bar, 3 tablespoons, into the ribs. That's a fine rack you've got there, Kingy.
Thank you, my dear fellow.
Save me 3 tablespoons of that, man.
No worries. Right, I'm just going to spread it out evenly. And then, once I've got an even layer on it, I'm going to start to rub it into that lovely meat. I'm going to switch this over for a little switchbackaroo. Make sure it goes right into that meat. You know, just love it, caress it, take it, possess it, make it your own.
Well, don't look too carried away, you'll get carted off.
Right, dude, that's us.
Beautiful job, mate. Now, the idea of these ribs, they must never be allowed to be dry.
No.
So we just put 100 ml of water in the bottom of the tin.
Cook the ribs in a preheated oven at 150 degrees Celsius for about 3 hours, and then finish them off on the barbecue.
Well, while that's doing, we could make the wet rub.
Why won't we?
Well, we will. And this has to cook for 5 minutes to infuse the flavours.
Right.
Ketchup, loads.
Tomato ketchup's rock and roll to me because it's naughty and you can put loads of it on your thingy in that.
To the ketchup, you add 75 millilitres of cider vinegar. Water, just fluid. Brown sugar, very much a sweet and sour vibe, this.
And the brown sugar counteracts the cider vinegar, so it's a nice balance.
Next, add 3 tablespoons of honey,
one tablespoon
of Worcestershire sauce, 3 tablespoons of leftover dry rub, and 3 ground cloves of garlic.
Should we have a little go?
Oh, yes. Susie Quattro.
Wow!
Whoa, that worked perfect.
It's brilliant, that.
Nothing else required, just a bit of heat, a bit of straining. That's the final flourish.
You know what that is? That's a power cord on your tonsils, that.
Now, hairy chums, it's time to do some painting in the garden. Look at that, mate. I have placed them in there. The dry rub has done its work.
Right now, time for the wet. And just paint it on. Oh, man, look at that. And then...
You want 3/4 of an hour of slow, slow cooking with the wet rub.
You can't be in a hurry when you're slow cooking, but we promise you, the results will be well worth the wait.
Dwayne, Eddie, they smell good.
Don't they? Oh, yes.
Yes, look at that.
That's us, dude.
It's like rhythm mahogany.
Oh.
Now these are tender. They are tender.
Oh, my darling. Yes.
Oh, they are dropping apart.
Aren't they? Oh, look at that.
That process of the dry and the wet rub has transformed a piece of stale old meat into a mink court.
Serve the ribs with some of the leftover sauce on the side and dunk them right in.
Oh, they are epic.
They're the best.
If you want to cook this at home or any of the other Southern delights, go to our website. It's good eating.
It kind of don't get much better than this.
No.
But actually, things are about to get even better. We're a short ride away from the legendary birthplace of rock and roll, Sun Studios.
This is where pioneering producer Sam Phillips recorded what's thought to be the first ever rock and roll song in 1951, Rocket 88 by Ike Turner.
You women have heard of jalopies, you've heard the noise they make, but let me introduce my new Rocket 88. Yes, it's straight.
It's like a shrine to rock and roll. I just can't resist having a go.
This is a dream come true.
Sun Studios drumsticks.
Oh.
While countless legends have played here, one man came to epitomise rock and roll more than any other, Elvis. And this is where he recorded his first hit in 1954.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama.
We've arranged to meet one of Elvis's closest friends, George Klein.
We grew up with, you know, rock and roll and Elvis in the stories, but to be here,
oh, it's just
slightly overawed, really.
Yeah, it just there was a name check of who's recorded.
Well, Elvis, Jerry Lewis, Johnny Cash, Roy Orbison, Carl Perkins, Ike Turner, B.B. King, Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf. The list is real long.
What is rock and roll for you, George?
Well, rock and roll to me changed the world.
Yeah.
Because until then, it was these middle of the road soft singers like Sinatra and, you know, Dean Martin and those guys. But Elvis comes along with rock and roll, and it changed the way we lived, it changed the way we talked, changed the clothes we wore at that time, changed the way we acted, we changed our language. It was a whole new thing, and not only just in America, but the entire world.
But your story starts earlier than that, doesn't it, George? We're back in high school with Elvis.
We go through high school in the exact same classes. We go to our senior year, I'm class president, when I put on a senior class talent show. And Elvis won the talent show. And I said, wow, maybe Elvis has got a shot, you know. And then I got my own radio show, and then Elvis would come by the station and visit with me. It was a middle-of-the-road radio station. I was the only rock and roll guy on the show, on the station. So they called me in one day after about a year and said, George, we don't think this rock and roll thing's gonna last. We think it's a fad. I said,
on that one.
Yeah. So as fate would have it, that very night I ran into Elvis. He said, why weren't you on the air today, GK? He called me GK. I said, Elvis, and I told him, he said, what, a fad? He said, well, you're not out of work anymore. I said, what am I gonna do? You're working for me. I need some guys to travel with me that I can depend upon.
What was Elvis like as a man?
Very giving, very thoughtful, very generous. Gave Cadillacs away. I never saw Elvis Presley refuse to shake hands with anybody. I never saw Elvis Presley refuse to sign an autograph. He said, GK, call the gates of Graceland and see if anybody down there tonight. If it's somebody there every night. About 10 o'clock at night, I said, yeah, Elvis, the guard says probably about 30 or 40 people down there. Good, tell them I'll be down to sign autographs in about an hour. He'd go down in the middle of the winter, stand there sign autographs, you know.
Right.
Elvis had that unique knack of making everybody in the audience or everybody who's listening to the music think that Elvis was doing it for them. I think there was an openness
to
Elvis.
He could communicate with the audience very well. Yeah. Yes, you're exactly right. And he just loved being in front of an audience. That was his first desire.
Elvis himself came from famously humble origins. He was born in Memphis in 1935 in a two-room house built by his father, but shot to fame at the age of just 19. He went on to become the best-selling solo artist in the history of popular music.